friends. They're just here to watch. Don't focus on them. Stay in here, like before.
Yes, Papa.
Many people are raving about the show Stranger Things, and I have to say it's very worthy of praise. It's a wonderful throwback to 1980s science fiction, and I'd say the sci-fi aspects alone make it worth anyone's time. And with only 8 episodes in season 1, it's not a huge investment either. The following section contains heavy spoilers. As I watched season 1, I really got the impression that 11 would be reunited with her real mother, Terry Ives, before all was said and done. And that, you know, Eleven's presence would be what brings her vegetable mother essentially back to the world of the living, so to speak. But that didn't really happen, you know, they didn't set it up that way. And so I guess they'll have to save that for the series finale. But what really sticks out to me after watching season 1 is the lack of an actual attempt at true resolution for Eleven, before the point Eleven was apparently vaporized. Why aren't Joyce and Hopper talking about what they'll do with Eleven after all this is over? Sure, they're preoccupied with finding Will. It's understandable that Joyce would let Eleven's best interest fall to the wayside while she's desperately trying to find her son. But it's not as understandable for Sheriff Hopper. After Joyce met Eleven's mother, Terry, and later met Eleven, I very much expected her to tell Eleven about her real mother. But she never did. This kind of begs the question, why introduce Eleven's real mother at all if the character was essentially a throwaway character? The knowledge that Eleven was likely taken at birth and labeled a miscarriage really does nothing to advance the main plot. And yet this is basically the only new detail Joyce and Hopper gained from this meeting with Eleven's mother and aunt. It does little more than add another tally under the heading Hawkins Labs equals bad guys, which is hardly news at this point in the story. However, what this meeting does do is shine light on how this action may have affected Eleven's mother, which beyond making her a sympathetic side character does nothing for the main plot. Or does it? I believe Eleven's mother was introduced into the story for a very specific reason. I get the impression that the Demogorgon beast from the Upside Down dimension is a remnant of another person's consciousness, another MK Ultra guinea pig with previous access to the Upside Down, having entered in the same way Eleven did, only much earlier. I believe that the Demogorgon monster is actually the tortured mind of Eleven's mother. The monster is likely the result of extended mental trauma on Terry's already LSD-soaked mind. The trauma of an apparent miscarriage killed her will to live and left her unwilling to accept the apparent truth of her daughter's demise. This trauma forced her mind to completely separate from her body and scour the previously trekked ether of the in-between in search of her daughter until she became trapped in the Upside Down. After years of searching yielded no results, the form of her mind's eye grew bitter, twisted, and deformed. Now with no other recourse and newfound access back to our dimension, she seeks out any kids she can find, still blindly hoping to find her lost child, using the rejects as hosts for a new litter of twisted children as she desperately tries to fill the void of motherhood. Well, that's the theory. And I find this theory is furthered by the completely vegetable mental state of Terry's physical body. She doesn't talk crazily, she didn't relapse to a childlike state causing her to babble incoherently. Her physical body is completely abandoned of any kind of consciousness. She is simply living on autopilot while her consciousness exists elsewhere, seeking blind, primal vengeance on anyone who gets in her way. This would explain why Eleven was able to find the Demogorgon so easily in her first few mental journeys. She was drawn to her mother. And I feel like Eleven admitting that her own actions made her the monster is a subtle nod by the writers to her bloodline and her relation to the actual monster. I also like that Eleven's consistently bloody nose is a perfect storytelling cover for any attraction the monster may have toward Eleven, which covers the fact that if the blood-smelling Demogorgon is drawn to her in any way, it is not necessarily because Eleven is her daughter, but if she is, the monster would be drawn to her because she could smell her own bloodline.
reaching out to you because it wants you. It's calling you. So don't turn away from it this time. I want you to find it. Understand?
I also kind of feel like the constant reminder of how the creature is faceless really evokes the question, you know, the mystery of identity. And that's a question that really doesn't belong in a conversation about a simple animal with no hidden motives or reasoning. And it's almost like it's a metaphor for the faceless victims of Dr. Brenner's actions or something like that, but it does seem oddly prevalent again and again. Well, that's my theory. You know, what do you think about it? Maybe I'm grasping at straws, but, you know, even if I am, it's a pretty cool theory, and one I'd be happy to see realized in later seasons of Stranger Things. Let me know in the comments below, you know, and hit me up on Twitter, @PlanetCalvin. Let me know what you think. I'm really interested. Be sure to subscribe for more content like this, and thanks for watching.